for this segment, we want to focus on New Zealand's economy of the future. We want to hear a vision from the both of you. I'm going to start with a philosophical question. Grant, to what extent is it the government's job to reshape our export economy?
It's certainly our job to support New Zealand to lift the value of our exports. It's not the job of the finance minister or anyone else in government to say to somebody, you must work in this sector. But what we can do is add value and find new markets, find new ways of New Zealanders making higher wages, doing that in a low emissions way, and making sure we deliver economic security. There is no single silver bullet for productivity in New Zealand, because if there had been, finance ministers over decades would have fired it. You've got to build on what we've been doing, new trade agreements that we've been able to sign, start adding value in our agricultural sector, the agri-tech support that we've given, which I think has been, you know, significant in lifting our performance there. Moving into a renewable energy space, the new economy, making sure we get science working towards driving new outcomes, game development sector, all those areas where we're good, and the government's job is to get alongside those who are doing that and lift the value of it.
Same question to you, Nicola.
So where growth comes from is an individual deciding, I'm going to do something new, I'm going to take a risk, I'm going to invest in that business, or I'm going to buy a big new piece of machinery, or I'm going to hire another 10 people, or I'm going to work an extra hour, I'm going to do an innovation, I'm going to do it a different way. Government's role is to create the conditions in which people will make those decisions. And so first, do no harm. Don't put too many barriers in the way in the form of red tape and regulation. Second, make sure that if there are issues that are getting in their way, you know, it's taking too long to get freight from port to the factory, then try and reduce those barriers. Make sure that they can get the skilled workers that they need. Make sure they're not in a high inflation, high interest rate environment. Help build access to foreign markets. The government's role is to create the conditions in which businesses and individuals want to invest and grow.
Okay, we're going to have a quick look at the exports as they stood, the top five exports in New Zealand in 2019. So this is pre-COVID-19. You'll remember at the time tourism was going through a particularly strong surge. 10 years from now, is there another sector that you think will feature in those top five, Nicola?
There's three that I've got my eye on that I'd like to see there. Export education, aquaculture, and software as a service.
Grant?
Yeah, on the latter of those, software as a service, I do think we need to see in there. I'd also like to see agricultural technology in there, and that to me is an example of the point I was making. We're brilliant. We've got great farmers, good sustainable farmers. Let's build on that. And the other one I'd throw into is around renewable energy. We are the best in the world at renewable energy, and we need to get not only that going for New Zealand to reach our 100% target, but also to make sure we're exporting that technology to the rest of the world. You know, the things that are in there will still be present because they're the core and the base of our economy. But there's tremendous opportunity to add value, to get into new markets and lift what New Zealanders get out of that in terms of their wages.
I don't want to make you pick between your babies, but what are each of your favourite policies, your single favourite policies when it comes to a policy that will drive productivity and growth?
So the best predictor of how productive our economy will be a decade, 15 years from now, is what's happening in our classrooms today. And we have an education problem in New Zealand where our children are learning less in reading, writing and maths than the generations that came before them. So we have to fix that, or not only our society and our community, but our economy is down the toilet. So what we're going to do is do the basics brilliantly in our schools. We're going to bring back an hour a day of reading, writing and maths. We're going to bring back a clear curriculum, structured literacy, assessment, progress reporting. We're going to get our kids educated.
I'm extremely proud, Jack, of the work we did to get New Zealanders into apprenticeships and into trade training. We've made a real dent in what was a skills deficit. But, you know, rather than pick that, I'll pick another one, and that's infrastructure. We've got to make sure that we actually invest properly in infrastructure over a sustained period. We've got $77 billion coming down the pipeline. That's the kind of thing the government can do. We do need to use our balance sheet as a government to do that. So we get some criticism coming about the fact we've taken on some more debt. But actually, that's what a government needs to do to make sure the hospitals, the schools, the roads, the housing are all there. So if we're going to succeed as a country, we need sustained long-term infrastructure investment.
Right. The infrastructure deficit is $200 billion in New Zealand by some estimates. What would a national government do differently in funding that infrastructure?
We want to work with the private sector in a way that just about every other developed country does. So what that means is that we work with things like the Super Fund, the Canadian Pension Fund, other big institutional investors around the world who want to invest in long-term infrastructure, and we give them revenue tools to finance the building of infrastructure. For example, we let them take a charge on development uplift that happens. We let them do a value uplift charge. We let them do tolls. We let them generate the revenue to pay off long-term infrastructure assets. There is huge potential for that. If we want to get the big roading projects that open up new land for housing, if we want to ensure we have the big public transport connections that allow intensification of housing in our cities, if we want to ensure that there is private capital able to go into renewable energy, then we have to be able to work much better with the private sector. And this government, Grant's going to tell you now that he wants to do that too, and he's talked about it and he's going to do it. They have failed to do it. Well, actually, you said you'd deliver light rail. Here we are 6 years later, and there still hasn't been a single metre of track laid. And actually, the New Zealand Super Fund had said to you they wanted to invest in it, and where's that got to?
Yeah.
Absolutely nowhere, Grant.
So we all believe that there is a role for the private sector, particularly in transport. One of the things I had to inherit, Jack, was the shambles that National created with Transmission Gully.
You were happy to be there with at the ribbon opening.
Indeed, because we worked really hard to save it from what you did to it. $800 million, they said it would cost, and then it ended up costing about $1.2 billion. So, Jack, there is a role for that. But at its core, addressing the infrastructure deficit requires the government to be at the centre of investment. And year after year under National, they underinvested, meaning that our hospitals weren't in the state they should have been, our schools weren't in the state they should have been. State housing, if National had built state housing at the rate that we're building it now, there'd be no one on the state housing register.
So I know
you actually have to invest as a government.
I know that the preview had absolutely no provision for Auckland Light Rail or the Harbour Crossing. So how are you going to fund those projects?
Well, the Harbour Crossing's outside of the prefu period in terms of its building. There is investment for Auckland Light Rail that was made in Budget 2022 that we're currently working through, and we will develop further costings on that. We don't disagree with Nicola that there's an opportunity there for value uplift to be used to be able to do that, the kind of congestion charging work that has been talked about. All of those are elements of funding infrastructure, but none of them work if the government isn't there at the
core. But no one's arguing about that, of course.
Well, we are,
I'll give you this commitment.
The next national
government will be making significant investments in nation-building infrastructure. I view that as one of the big tasks the next national government will have.
It's a pity
we
you
will
didn't
be
do
building,
it last time.
And it's very difficult to take your pledges seriously. When you sat there and promised light rail for Wellington, you promised light rail for Auckland, none of it's been built. One of the first actions of your new government was to cancel the state highway pipeline
which
of projects.
Which had no funding,
then you realised that
there
that was the
no
wrong thing to
it.
Do. And then you turned it back on again, and they get turned off again, turned on again, and you talk to anyone who's involved in the delivery of infrastructure in this country, and they say it's been a shambles under Labor.
Absolute rubbish, Nicola. Absolute rubbish.
OK, we'll give you a chance to respond to that in a few minutes.